So thank you, Sergi, for the great introduction about this project. And also thank you all for staying until the last talk of this amazing conference. So we are here to talk about computer vision at the edge with WebAssembly. My name is Ángel, and I'm part of the AI and Advanced Services group in Broadcom. But today, I'm here more as a WebAssembly and computer vision enthusiast.
Oh, hello, everyone. I'm Miguel Ángel. I'm a former engineer from Bitnami and VMware. Now I'm the founder of Pipeless, but we will be talking about Pipeless in a few minutes. So first of all, what is computer vision? As you probably know, it is about extracting data from images and videos that represent what is actually happening on those images and videos. Some examples of computer vision are protective equipment detection in the construction industry, traffic analytics like we can see there, or analyzing players' performance in sports. So what do you need to build the most basic computer vision application? So basically, you need some multimedia pipelines. Those pipelines take care of ingesting the video, like that can come from an RTSP stream, WebRTC, directly from a webcam, and then they extract raw frames. Raw frames are basically arrays of pixels, so they are like numbers. And once you have those raw frames, you need to convert them into something that your computer vision model can understand. So that's what we call the pre-processing step. Your model will delegate the inference to your GPU or whatever hardware you have using some runtimes, and then it will produce an output that you need to convert into some structured data that is easy to work with. And that is what we call the post-processing. So to give you some context, all this needs to happen just in milliseconds. If you have a more complex application, you need to replicate the structure below that blue line several times. So you may have different models, different processing logic for each model, and sometimes even different, several video streams. So if I'm new to computer vision, how do I get started? How do I start creating the boxes above? Which libraries or frameworks can I use to build those boxes? You don't have so many options. There are some libraries, like GStreamer, to create multimedia pipelines, but they are not actually easy to use. Also, how do I parallelize the code? I mean, that processing code, the pre-processing and post-processing step need to be parallelized to take advantage of the full capacities of the device. Also, you may want to run sometimes using the wall capacity, using all the cores that you have available in the device. And other times, like when you are performing some kind of object tracking, you may want to maintain some kind of internal state that performs some sequential processing on the frames, so it has the context of what is happening before the frame that it is actually processing. And also, how do you distribute your applications? You may want to run this on the cloud, you may want to run this on a heterogeneous device fleet, where each device has a different architecture or has a different operating system. Or, well, as we have seen in other talks, maybe they don't even have an operating system. And here is where Pipeless comes to the rescue. Pipeless is an open source framework for computer vision that allows you to build and deploy applications in minutes. To Pipeless, you just need to provide Pipeless with video sources, and it will automatically produce structured and actionable data streams to you. So those data streams are easy to work with, just like you work with other, you know, like when you work with normal data. So you don't even need to know anything about computer vision to create vision-powered applications. And how does Pipeless know what kind of data it has to extract from those video sources? Here is where filters come into play. So for us, a filter has three main steps, just like in the architecture before. We have the pre-processing step, which for Pipeless is basically a function that receives a raw frame, that data array, that converts that into something that our model understands. Then we have a processing step, which can be a function or can be defined in JSON format, where you specify the inference runtime to use, which kind of execution provider you want to use. It can be like NVIDIA CUDA, TensorRT, OpenBINO, or whatever. And then the post-processing step, which is also a function that receives the processing output and converts that into the data that is structured and that you can easily work with later. So this is an example of a very basic filter that will perform object detection. It will basically perform the object detection and export the bounding boxes in an structured format. So as you can see, we have a pre-processing function, which is writing in Python in this case. It obtains the frame data and returns something, you know, it performs like resizing, some kind of normalization on the pixels. That is passed to the processing step, in which we are defining this JSON that specifies to use the ONNX runtime. We have there a model URI, which is basically where we have a file hosted in an S3 bucket that Pipeless can download and instantiate that model locally. And the execution provider, like, as I said, it can be TensorRT, CUDA, or whatever. And then we have the post-processing function, which takes the output from that processing step and returns the structured data. In this case, they are going to be bounding boxes. So this is a 9 seconds video from a drone, which has a frame rate of 24 frames per second. And we are going to be using this video for the next couple of demos. So this demo is going to show, can you play, Ángel? Yeah, thanks. So this demo is going to show the filter that we have defined above and over the video that we have just shown. There we are running Pipeless. Once Pipeless has loaded the filters and is already running, we'll expose the interface, and in the other terminal, we provide a video source, and it automatically starts processing that, extracting our frames. You maybe will notice that that video, the output, has been like faster than the original video, and this is because Pipeless was able to process that video at 31 frames per second, which is actually faster than the original one. So yeah, I'm going to let Ángel now.
So thank you for this great introduction about Pipeless and computer vision, but we are here at Wasm.io. So where is WebAssembly in this model, and what are the benefits that it can bring? So to talk a little bit more about Wasm, let me travel back a little bit in time and talk to you about 6 months ago. So as Miguel Ángel mentioned before, we were working together in the past in different companies, and we usually catch up about the projects that we are working on. So 6 months ago, we met in a cafe, and we started talking about Pipeless and how it was solving certain problems with computer vision. So just to give you a little bit more context about what happened at that time, Pipeless 6 months ago was a full Python project in which all the filters that Miguel Ángel was mentioning before and showing before were written also in Python. It has some kind of performance issues, especially related about parallelization, but it was actually working pretty well. Another problem was also that both the platform and the filters were big size artifacts. Since you may run Pipeless in different kind of environments, from a cloud environment to an edge device, you don't want to actually use like big size artifacts, because yeah, if you're running this in a store, you may not have even a good network access. So after talking about this, we started brainstorming some ideas around this. So we discussed it since the same challenges that we were discussing before. For example, in the developer experience side, we were thinking about, hey, can we provide tools to simplify how you develop filters and reuse some tooling that is around? Also, it's true that for machine learning, most of users and developers are used to work with Python, but there are other most likely there are other developers that are used to work in different languages that can take advantage of Pipeless, and that may help to grow the ecosystem of Pipeless to other kind of developers. About performance and stability, we want to ensure that all the filters perform properly and that you can effectively parallelize them, so you can take advantage of the full hardware that is running underneath, that basically filters run anywhere. And also about distribution. So if you have worked before with Python applications in which you need to bundle huge libraries and a lot of them inside one artifact, it's made complex and you get big artifacts. So can we simplify this too? Of course, as a good citizen of this amazing community, I ask like, Miguel Ángel, did you hear about WebAssembly? This was the time in which, after discussing all the different benefits, you see clear that WebAssembly can bring many benefits to Pipeless. If we think about the diagram that Miguel Ángel just showed before, we can say, for example, that instead of writing filters in pure Python, why not defining them as WebAssembly components, so you can use any language? And if new languages can target the component model and WebAssembly components, Pipeless can take advantage of it without having to create custom SDKs, for example, for every language. So now we have Wasm for pre-processing and post-processing. You can also instantiate multiple filters in parallel because every filter runs totally isolated, which means that you also get more security and can like make them keep them under control, so a filter cannot just blow up the entire system. Also, if you convert filters to WebAssembly models, basically any filter runs in any environment that Pipeless can run. Before, if you were working with Python to create the different filters, you may need to install certain libraries that may not be compatible with the target environment. And finally, you define a pretty strong and proper interface using Compose Model. But the key thing here is that you can also split and create some small models that can contain common actions that users may want to run against the streams, and then you can compose them, creating small and shareable units that anyone can take advantage from. So just to recap and to see, to talk about the evolution from Pipeless, 6 months ago, it was a Python project, both the core or the platform and also the filters. Then, after like a lot of work, Miguel Ángel moved the entire project to Rust just to gain more control and stability. But as a first step and to continue supporting Python as the guest language for the filters, integrated Pyo 3 as the way to do it. And finally, and this is why we are here, you have already support, experimental support for WebAssembly models as filters. And we are now going to talk a little bit more about implementation details, challenges, and benefits of this journey.
Thank you, Ángel. So this is going to be just 3 more slides before the second demo. We had 3 main challenges when integrating with WebAssembly. The first one was that in Pipeless we have a concept that we call stateful versus stateless filters. Stateful filters are, just like I was commenting before, there are some cases when you need to have some kind of internal state. You need to perform some kind of sequential processing, and you need to maintain a state of what happened on the frames that you processed before. So for that, this kind of filter was actually easy to implement. You just have to acquire a log, call the component function and release the log, and that's all. However, we also support stateless filters. Stateless filters allows you to take advantage of all the capacity of your CPU, GPU, or whatever, and use all the cores that are available. And this was more complex to implement because at Pipeless we are using Tokyo for the multi-threading support and Wasm time for the Wasm runtime. And when you work with Wasm time and you want to call a function on a component, you need to call that function passing a mutable store that must be the same store that was used to instantiate that component. So you cannot acquire a lock in this case, because if you acquire a lock, you are locking basically all the threads on that component. So what we did instead was to instantiate a component per Tokyo thread. And in that way, each thread can run the processing, the pre-processing or post-processing hook without having to lock the rest of the threads. So you can run several frames at the same time. The second challenge, this is more than a challenge because we have not been able to solve this, but it has been a problem that we faced during the development, is that Python with Wasm is very slow. However, as Ángel mentioned before, computer vision users love Python. They are mostly researchers or people that are not actually developers. And Python is easy to understand, is easy to write, and it's basically easy to use. So there is something that is very interesting to comment here, and that's why this slide is there, and it's the fact that in Python, you have something that is called the global interpreter locker that doesn't allow you to actually run multi-threading. So the global interpreter locker basically locks the Python interpreter when some thread is running, not allowing you to run to create real parallelism between different threads. That limitation can be overcome with Wasm, but it comes with the cost of memory. If you remember the slide just before this one, we have stateless hooks. And when you use componentized pies to create Python components, which, by the way, is a great project, it instantiates a Python interpreter. And when you create stateless hooks with Pipeless, we are instantiating a component per thread. So you are actually creating several Python interpreters at the same time, and that consumes a lot of memory. And the last one is the time that it takes to copy memory from the host to the Wasm guest, let's say, or to the Wasm memory. To work around this, what we did was basically to obtain a reference to the frame in the host, map that to a random value that we pass into the Wasm component, and then we inject into the Wasm component a library of common operations that the user can call and will basically invoke the actual operation on the host with the frame reference. So, this is our second demo, which is going to show the same that we saw before, but instead of using Python functions, here we are using Wasm components. Just to clarify, the previous demo was using Python functions using Pyo3, and in this case, we are going to be loading the filter using Wasm components. So as you can see here, we have there the filters of the files of the filter. We have a post-processing hook, which is a Python component, and a pre-processing hook, which is a Rust component, so we can easily mix languages. Now, Pipeless is loading those filters. It takes a bit longer than before because Python components are heavy, and it exposes the interface, and now in the other terminal, we provide the video. And you will see here that we have a similar result, but in this case, it is slower. So why this is slower is basically because of the fact that Python components are not very performant. Something that is interesting here is that even though Python components are not very performant, if you write that post-processing step using a Rust component, it can even beat the first demo that we saw. So yeah, this time it was able to process that at around 8 frames per second. And just to recap what we have been talking about, we expect a bright future for Pipeless using Wasm. It allows us to run untrusted code securely, because after all, filters are untrusted code. You don't know who have written those filters. It is easy to share those filters, and we can also support several languages. Also, as I mentioned before, there are some ways of getting rid of the limitations of the Python multithreading. Still, there are some things that we need to improve. As I said, Python components are slow. Well, we have seen here in other talks some ways of improving the performance of Python with Wasm. There is still a lack of support for libraries that are really useful in computer vision, like OpenCV. Still, we are performing a kind of complex workaround to avoid copying that memory from the host to Wasm. I have to say that this last point is going to be fixed very soon, because Wasm Time is adding support for resources, which is a type on the width that allows you to avoid that copy of the memory, just maintaining a handle to the host memory. It's a work in progress, so we hope to have that ready very soon. And with that, we have finished the presentation, so I hope it hasn't been too heavy. Okay, so are there any questions? Well,
just curious, as a developer new to WebAssembly, what was the most surprising thing, either surprisingly difficult or surprisingly easy, versus what the expectation was to kind of add WebAssembly to an existing project?
Yeah, that's a good question. I will say the most complex part here has been implementing that logic for avoid copying the memory. I know this is probably something that many people won't face, because this is like a special case where we are copying that, like a really big data structure from the host to the Wasm memory. But I will say that has been the most complex, or at least the most time-consuming part to implement securely. I will say so. So are there any other questions? OK. Well, so thank you very much for being here at the last talk. We will be around, so if you have some questions, you can just reach out.
Thank you.